This is Michael's prayer. Lord, take me where you want me to go. Let me meet who you want me to meet. Tell me what you want me to say, and keep me out of your way.
He went flying around the city, you know, robes flying and all behind him, and always going, and yet always stopped at the chat.
Not seeking anything for himself, but seeking to share God's love with the person he's talking to.
He's good looking, big, great hair. The priest used to kid him about loving a mirror.
Powerful hands, like a carpenter or construction worker.
I couldn't help but notice he had an earring.
There was very little you could say to Michael that would shock him. He was a monk of the world.
And he had this great, wonderful laugh about him. I call it wild. It was a wild laugh.
I was walking down 31st Street, and he was crossing the street, and he was in his full fire chaplain regalia, you know, the uniform with the hat, and he looked fabulous. I mean, he looked fabulous.
His whole ministry was about love.
He was the perfect Franciscan.
I hope I'm not making him out to be a really holy Joe. He was so human.
He'd be vastly amused at the idea of being a saint.
Michael wasn't the one to judge. He had judged himself enough and then found freedom.
Life and death. So valuable. And you wonder when my last half hour is going to be, or my last hour, what it'll be. Will it be doing something for someone, trying to save a life?
Well, here we go with another edition of City Folk Morning. This one for a Tuesday, September the 11th. Going to be a sunny day with highs in the 80s today. The Carol Burnett Show debuted 34 years ago today. It's Brian De Palma's 61st birthday. It is Election Day. New York City voters going to the polls, a mayoral primary, a comptroller up for grabs, public advocate. Julianne will be by with news headlines in just a couple of minutes. It is 8:51, and we are trying to sort out the details of something truly terrible that has happened this morning at the World Trade Center. A very large explosion there, high up.
We were flying into Newark at 10 to 9. And Diana said, "Does the World Trade Center always pollute like that?" And I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "Well, there's a burst of smoke just came out of it."
It pours out like slow. It's not like it's fanning flames. Like, it was just a very, very slow pouring smoke. I turned around and ran back to the friary. I went in and said, "Michael, I just saw the jet," and told him the story. And with that, he said, oh my God," got up, took his habit off, got in his fire clothing. And I remember saying, "Good luck and have a good day and God be with you and I love you."
Father Judge and some of the other chaplains would normally come to something like that where the tragedy is the worst, hoping to be of help if anybody was seriously injured. We didn't talk much. You know, I remember saying to him, "How you doing?" And he's, "Okay." You know, that kind of thing. And then I was busy. And he looked like he was praying. He looked like he was, to me, looked like he was mouthing the prayers. You know, he could see his lips moving. That's what I thought. I saw a concern on his face that I didn't normally see.
You know, my first instinct was, I got to get down there. You know, I got to get down to the tower. So I ran down and I made it to about Chamber Street. which is about four blocks, I believe, from the trade centers, and the first tower collapsed.
The sound was so big that you just heard, like, all the people that were down there, like, it just took their breath away. Like, the sound was, like, hit you right in the chest. Like, it, like, sucked all the air out.
I ran and made it to the base of the tower that was still standing. And it was this real eerie light. It was a weird day, you know. There was this beautiful light coming in, and as I was getting near the tower, people were starting to evacuate down the stairs. I noticed that there was a group, like a firemen and police and FBI and emergency services carrying this man. So I started making some frames, and the one fireman started yelling at me, you know, stop taking photos, stop taking photos. I kept shooting.
Such a striking photograph. These big men, obviously in anguish, and Michael limp and serene at the same time in their arms. You know, it reminded me a lot of the Pieta.
This is how Michael would have prayed to have had the last day of his life transpire, doing what he loved. This was one of the most horrific moments in American history, and he would have been nowhere else on the face of the earth but with all those folks. Michael wasn't a hero in 9/11. He was doing his job.
He loved the fire department, and they loved him. And he proved it. He could have left the Trade Center. Mayor Giuliani told us that he said to Michael, come with us. And he said, no, I have to stay with my men.
He was one of the gang, you know. He'd come in the firehouse, he'd eat with us, he'd hang out.
He was a living, walking saint.
Father Mike has always done great things for us, always. Baptized our children, he's performed our weddings. He has always gone above and beyond the duty for the firefighters and for the police department.
If anyone symbolized the sacrifices of New Yorkers, of firefighters, police officers, EMTs, paramedics, it was Michael.
He was our spiritual leader, but he was our buddy too.
One part of Michael's personhood is his sexuality, and it was something he wasn't afraid to talk about because it humanized him. It was out of that need and that want that we all have to connect, to touch, to feel. That was what empowered him, in good part, to be such an effective minister.
He was proud, I think, of the way he looked. I used to kid him a lot when I'd see him with women. I used to say, if they only knew. He liked wearing a uniform, too. He looked great in our uniform, just a white collar. He fit right in. I talked to him about being gay a lot. I never had the sense that he was in any way ashamed of being gay. It was definitely something that he didn't want people to know about in the fire department. And I think that he felt it would compromise his ability to help so many of them if that became something that he had to deal with every day. I think that he felt strongly about what good men they were, and they bonded with him immediately.
People loved him because they clearly saw that he went where the love took him, you know, and sometimes that was a painful place.
It was very important for us to learn that God wanted us as priests. If we had been honest and told everyone we were gay, they would have refused to ordain us. So we were hypocrites.
He walked a particular road and prayed for the strength to be able to walk it.
He wanted to be a minister to the whole world. In his day, in the 1980s, you could not publicly announce yourself as gay and remain an acceptable minister in the straight world. That was not possible. So he had to make a choice to remain publicly closeted and only to come out of the closet to those who would understand and accept him in his gayness.
You know, it was a tricky, a difficult line he walked. He wanted not to scandalize, not to harm the firefighters. He wanted to be their chaplain. He wanted to be available to them. And he didn't want to scandalize in the sense that some might not be able to cope if they knew he were gay, you know. But he didn't want that to interfere with his availability, his service, his love, his sharing the faith with them. And so that was his way of safeguarding them. I'd say as maybe much more so than safeguarding himself.
Just when I thought I had Michael Judge sorted out, all of a sudden Michael would catch me by surprise. I will never forget the day I got the call from him inviting me to a dinner dance that was being organized by the Emerald Society of the New York City Fire Department. In fact, he told me on the phone that he was being honored at this event as Irishman of the Year. Michael Judge was bringing all of the people in his life together, his family, the Pipers, the fire department. There was room for us all in Michael Judge's heart. And that he would want Tom and I there meant so much to both of us. But remember then when it came time for dancing and Michael coming down, and to be very honest with you, as a gay man, I have to admit that I was sort of thinking we're actually going to have to sit this through and let the others get up and dance together. And I remember Michael coming down and saying, you know, make sure you get up and dance.
Do you know, whatever, how he expressed his sexuality, it wouldn't colour my thinking of him any less. I think he just was a very good man and he loved so many. And for me, that's what we're all called to. I know that seems a bit preachy, but that's what I feel.
I don't know what's next for me. I pray all the time for guidance on how to make decisions. I get down on my knees and pray, Lord, help me, show me. Take me, mold me, fashion me. Show me what you want. I watch and I listen, and it will come. The phone will ring, or someone will just ask for something. It just happens like it has for years.
It was the early 80s, and we met for dinner at the Sheridan Square Diner in New York, and Michael asked me what I did besides travel. And I told him that I was working with the gay men's health crisis. And Michael wanted me to explain that to him, so I said to him that this issue of GRID, gay-related immune deficiency, was really becoming a problem, and that each one of us would take 3 or 4 or 5 patients. They were really shut-ins. They couldn't go out, and they needed counseling and just another person in their lives, because so many people abandoned them. People of their good friends were worried that they were going to catch whatever it was that they had.
I had many, many friends who were hospice volunteers who basically dropped out during the AIDS epidemic because, as they would say to me, I really feel bad for these guys, I don't have anything against them, but I have a husband and children, and my husband would kill me if anybody got sick. So that was the general sense of non-knowing. And I found it carried over even to hospital personnel, medical professionals. It broke my heart to be in a room with a patient who was suffering intensely, was in a darkened room because of sensitivity to the light, in total isolation, red flags all over his door, almost as if he was some kind of a disease himself. And a door would open without any knocking, and a tray would be pushed in on a wheeling table by someone from dietary who was wearing double robes and double layers of gloves. It was just such a fear. It created such a sense of indignity and non-caring.
And I told Michael my patient is very sick and that they had removed an eye and that they had removed his testicles. And they, in those days, I think maybe they thought they could cut it off or cure it or remove it like a cancer. But anyway, I said to Michael, my patient would really like to talk to a gay priest. And Michael sort of blanched. He was so shocked. He said that's the moment that it clicked. That he drove back to New Jersey and he suddenly realized what God wanted him to do. When Michael went home that night, he noticed people in New York City. He noticed that he had to be in the Mecca. He felt very isolated. He felt that he could do so much more for people. That was a turning point for him. The next day in the morning, Michael came over in his habit, and he had the ropes and the full sandals and the whole outfit. He walked into the hospital, and the strangest thing happened because Michael didn't put on a mask. And here was this poor guy who had body parts removed, and Michael went in and kissed him on the lips.
There was a very, very deep identification because these were the brothers that were dying of this disease, you know, that was preying on us. And in fact, what was happening to him and to everybody else at that moment in history in 1987, 88, all the way up through 93, was that your phone book was being wiped out. You know, you just had crosses in your phone book of people that were dead.
I think it was before a month had gone by, Michael said to me, I talked to my superiors and I want to come back to New York City. I want to be with the poor. I want to be with the homeless. I want to be with the people sick with AIDS. And he really got into it. He just came over and he couldn't see enough. He became the priest walking through the ward at St. Vincent's Hospital. He became very involved with the gay men's health crisis. He was very involved at fundraisers. His presence was just seen.
He would go to the hospitals and look up people dying of AIDS and go into their room, and very frequently he would be rejected because they would see a church figure and see the church as their enemy, and legitimately so at the time, what the hierarchy were saying and doing. And this really hurt him. He wanted to bring the messages of God love, and they refused to speak to him. It wouldn't have anything to do with them, you know. And it really pained him terribly. And so he told me he prayed very hard, asking God to tell him how to get around that hostility and that rejection and be able to perform his task. And he told me one day that he found the answer. He would take holy oil, sacred chrism, into the hospital room, and before he talked to the person, he would roll back the blankets and massage his feet, even if they had Kaposi sarcoma and blemishes. He would spend a good time massaging their feet and then talk to them. And almost every time he did that, the hostility would fall away, and he was able to enter into a spiritual conversation.
I don't plan anything. I come into their presence and silently pray. Lord, be with us. Let your will be done in our lives. Show us. Have mercy on us. You see, I'm only the instrument. It's not me. It's the Lord. It's his world. I respond with empathy and ask how I can help them.
It was Ron who answered the phone at 1 a.m, and as soon as he heard it was I, he said, Mia, I don't know how it happened, but I've got AIDS. And I nearly collapsed myself. It was just like a knife going through my heart. And Ron kept saying, Mia, how soon can you come down? Lan needs you.
Ron loved to be photographed.
and he loved us to be photographed together. And really, I think one of the reasons why that he was ready to die was because he had the photo. And he told me this is the photo, because he didn't want an open casket. Yeah.
There came a point where Ron did call me and start talking about whether there was any possibility of his receiving the last rites. And I assured him, of course there is. And he said, but his experience, as that of so many others, was that don't even bother making confession if you're not going to change your lifestyle. So with all his illness, he still had the feist to say, I am not changing who I am. I can't change who I am. And Larry was the one who said, well, what about this Father Michael?
It was sort of funny. Ron forgot the Our Father or something, and Father Michael made a joke about it or tried to help him. And it was cute.
He then explained the sacrament of anointing of the sick and said, I will be making the sign of the cross with a blessed oil on each of your senses. And I'd like you to join me in thanking God for the gift of those senses, for everything you've seen, everything you've heard, for the ability to speak, to express your love and your joy and your pain, and for everything you've touched and felt, and for all the places your feet have been able to take you to. And if, as I give you those blessings, you want to join me in saying, and also forgive me for any failure to accept this gift, then you just say, please forgive me.
Mom was in a wheelchair and very frail and, you know, wasted.
After anointing Ron, Michael went on with some of the prayers of the Mass and got to the point of communion and gave communion to each of us, then put the chalice down on the table and bent over and picked Ron up in his arms and just held him to himself and rocked and kissed him on the head. I will never forget it, because that man had said to me so many times, Mary, does God hate me? And I'd always say, sweetheart, God could not hate you. He cherishes you. He made you who you are, and he loves who you have become. And here was Michael standing in for God, holding him in his arms and crooning to him.
He didn't have to do that. But I think he really had love for people and really understood what love was.
Michael celebrated the funeral mass and began by facing the family, Ron's parents, who, after all, had struggled for a lifetime with a very unusual son, and who had a lot of cultural reasons to feel uncomfortable about who Ron was. And Father Michael stood there and looked right down at them with the most tender and caring expressions and mentioned them by name and said, how proud you must be. And all I could think of was, this is the first priest I've ever heard tell the parents of a gay boy that you should be proud of him. The most I'd ever heard anyone do was try to tell them how to cope and not blame themselves. This was so totally different. And Michael went on to say what a great gift Ron was to the family. And that gift was so magnified by his love for Larry. And that their whole family would be forever blessed by the love that Larry and Ron had shared.
I don't think any of us knew at that time, least of all Michael, of the power that he was bringing to this, the spirituality that he was bringing to a community that really needed it.
For sure, I marched to a different drummer. I just don't belong to the church of so many of these priests. They are good men to the core, but in a different church than myself. But that's okay.
He had that direct line to God, you know, and therefore the church couldn't get in his way.
For 15 years, gay and lesbian Catholics have been able to attend a special Sunday evening mass sponsored by an organization of Catholic homosexuals known as Dignity.
Dignity was part of a flourishing movement of renewal that was taking place within the Catholic Church. Michael, of course, like many others, sought out this community and felt very much at home and made important friendships there. So as well as being an important minister to this community, it also became, I would say, a family for him.
Our Father, who art in heaven.
Of course, all that changed in October 1986. The Vatican issued a letter on the pastoral care of homosexuals in the church. This letter was issued at the height of the AIDS crisis. And here was this word coming from the Vatican, from the heart of our church, from our leadership. It actually came from the CDF, which is the Congregation for the Doctrine and the Faith, headed at that time by Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, now Pope Benedict XVI. Our church was sending a message which for all of us was a message of rejection, of hostility. At a time, in fact, when our community needed support, comfort, and reassurance.
Homosexual Catholics in New York protesting the eviction of their organization, Dignity, from St. Francis Xavier Church by the New York Archdiocese.
I will never forget that night in March 1987 when we had our final liturgy at St. Francis Xavier. This candlelight procession of literally a people in exile. Many of the priests also received word from the Chancery that they could no longer support our community. And each priest had to decide what they would do.
Michael couldn't be contained by structures. And yet he loved structure. He loved the church. But he had a different vision of the church. Remember, he was a Franciscan. He had a vision of the church, which is about bringing the Word of God to people.
The next memory I have of Michael is Christmas Eve, when we were meeting in the Lesbian and Gay Community Center. For many of us, and for many in the community at the time, I remember, that was actually very lonely. As Catholics, somehow, they missed the ambience of the church. Maybe the smells and bells, they just missed it. They missed the feel of the sacred space. We were sitting around wondering, would he arrive? But he did. He actually lifted out of his bag Jesus in the manger, this little statue, and used it as part of his homily that night. I think the beautiful thing was, we were not abandoned. That Michael was there with us as part of our community.
Everything was really surreal. I wouldn't say it was slow motion, but it was just, you were seeing things with your eyes that your mind just couldn't comprehend for the moment. You know, we were stopping at that point, and just anybody we passed, it was another firefighter, or we would just ask them, did you hear anything about Ladder 12? Do you know, did you see where they were? Did you see them? Anybody from our battalion, we were just asking for them, and they said no, but the chaplain is in the church. And then they said he's dead, and I immediately knew it was Michael Judge. All of a sudden it was just very dark. There was this dust in the air and papers were flying everywhere. There was no color anywhere. It was just trees were covered, cars were covered, buildings were covered. Nothing had color to it. And when we opened the doors to the church, it was like you opened into a world of color. What light was coming through was filtering through stained glass windows, and the church just for that moment was so pure looking. You could see Michael Judge's body up on the altar. We just knelt down and everybody had tears coming down and said whatever quick prayer we could and again stood up knowing that we just had to keep going. We made our way out of the church and we traced our steps picking up our tools and continued on our way.
God is present, loving, smiling, having received our loved ones. They are in his presence, illumined by his smile and warmed by his love. His kingdom is enriched this day, so enriched by so many beautiful souls. So much beauty.
Let me tell you, he says, when you're walking down the street and you're wearing your habit, he says, just look everybody in the eye and say hi.
I said, well, he's a Franciscan friar. And one of the women looked at me and she said, oh, what a waste. What a waste. This guy is so beautiful. And then she said, I've never known a man of the cloth, but now I do, and I feel so good.
He would try to get us all to sing. He was terrible, we were worse, but he would always try.
I raised a lot of people's eyebrows. I told him I loved this man to bits.
He always have a smile on his face.
I really, really would have loved to have known him in life.
Over the period I've had AIDS, I've been in St. Vincent's Hospital at least a dozen times where Michael had come to anoint me. And those are important times. And certainly something I now will miss, knowing I will die without his physical being there.
The miracles that man wrought of bringing people into a good life, into sobriety. Astounding, the amount of people that he brought in.
I used to be surprised when, for instance, an envelope arrived from Michael, and among the notes in the envelopes might be, for instance, a recipe for Irish soda bread. In fact, I think he actually probably, over the years, he sent it to me about 3 times.
So I would walk across the street. Wee, wee, wee. I said, well, what I did? You know, why is the cop stopping me for? Look, I told you never know where I'll be. I said, oh, Father Michael, how could you do this to me?
Michael would always say, have a cup of tea and sing a song, and we could find some peace and understanding.
His parting gift to us was his dedication and his compassion and his heroism to stay with us right to the end.
God never let Michael Judge think he was special. He left him with all his struggles and his problems and his depressions and his doubts and fears. And so Michael never knew he was the saint. Michael thought he was one of the worst sinners.
He wouldn't want people to be burning candles in front of his statue. He would want them to be carrying that light within them. Be the best parent you can be and do it with all your power. Be the best lover you can be. Be the best spouse you can be. Be the best kid you can be. Be the best mayor you can be. Be the best cardinal you can be. Be about the people you love. Put your own needs second. That's what Michael would say.